There we go.
I haven't been nowhere close.
No fair.
Where the ladies class at?
Somebody show up.
I didn't get the memo, they didn't get the memo.
Yes, I guess. Y'all do good.
Oh, there you go.
Oh, okay, we got.
Yeah, oh, you got lucky. Well, I tell you, we have a lesson here today dealing with one of the most important writers, or the most important writer, probably, of Jewish literature, of wisdom. Jewish literature. Jewish wisdom literature. Written by none other than David's boy. Solomon. From his perspective, we have to keep in mind that he was looking at it from a perspective of not eternal life. He didn't know anything about everlasting. I don't think he did. Scripture hasn't proved it to me that he knew anything about everlasting life as we would, as we do. And so we're going to take it from his perspective anyway, about wisdom, obtaining wisdom, operating, taking advantage of wisdom. There is a choice in life. Life gives us a choice to operate in or outside of wisdom. And as long as you know what the score is, you can take your pick. Free game. And so the wisdom of God now, 1 Corinthians 1 and 30, we can see that. Let's look at that real quick as New Testament believers. Somebody can tell me what that says without even turning there. Somebody other than Sister Candy. I already told her what it says. First, no, I probably but she knows. I know she knows. 1 Corinthians 1 and 30. It's one of those scriptures I think every believer should be able to quote right off the bat, because it covers the whole you, 360 of you walking today. Since somebody saw my house, Sister King, go ahead and tell us before we turn. You should always know that this scripture is dealing with wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption.
But of him are ye in Christ Jesus.
But of him are ye in Christ Jesus.
Well, God has made
whom God
into
has
us.
Made into us.
Wisdom.
God has made into us. Us. Okay, now. Doesn't mean that we can be lazy and that wisdom of God just kind of flows through the air like a leaf and lands on us in our yard. You know? Kind of like me. Before long, I got to get out there and rake because the leaves are just going to show up. You know, that's not how wisdom is going to find us. Even the wisdom of God, it takes a little effort on your part to really to operate, handle, take advantage of what you have. So we of him are you in God, right? God, of him has God made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. And he takes all of those things that you have and you utilize them for your benefit today. Come out on top. So Solomon, back in his day, determined that he had to dig and search and find out what wisdom was. And he did it in the natural. He did it to work toward his advantage. The life lessons, life skills, life experiences turned him around to his advantage. And he did it better than any man of his day and most men since. he studied it out, he checked it out, but he said, as he did, you got a choice. You can choose this path or you can choose not to take this path, as long as you know what the outcome is going to be. So let's see what Solomon had to say. So long as we know who we are, let's go see what he did back in the day. Okay. We do know, just right off the bat, without even studying, that Solomon had everything. He had everything. He had it made. Not only was he a king's kid, but he acquired, obtained, and did everything, that got what he wanted, but he still had to, in life, choose this life skill to make his life worthwhile. Now, you can have all of the material stuff and still not have this one skill, how to operate in wisdom, and it can all come to naught that you have accumulated. For example, I read in the paper or something on the internet, somewhere, that T.O. broke. Guys, you know, said follow sports, you know, come on. And that's why he wants to get back in the league.
He broke.
He says that his advisors messed up, made some raw investments, some bad investments, and he's broke.
Always blame it on me.
Always, yeah.
He should be ready to go sit in the sun somewhere, enjoy all those millions that he made, you know, that he had under his, you know. Okay, Gatlin, now it takes life skills to make this stuff to your advantage. Broke. So you can have everything and still not have a drop of wisdom. You know, materialistic at all, you know, and still not having. And really, that's what we as believers have. We have everything. Bible says he's giving it all to you. But now we got to figure out life skills, experiences, how to make it work for my advantage. Okay, so let's see. What's Solomon say? Let's start off with his book first. His book of Ecclesiastes. Unique book in the Bible. One of the unique books in the Bible. Written by a Jew. Jewish wisdom in literature. Okay, chapter 1, verse 1. This is what he says real quick there. The words of the who? Chapter 1, verse 1.
The preacher.
I know our lessons in the 9th chapter, but let's figure out this guy who wrote all this stuff first. He said, the words of the who?
Preacher.
Preacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. The words. Here's my book. Bestseller. Here's my book. Vanity of vanities, said the preacher. Let's look and see some things that he has to say here. Verse 4. One generation passed away, another generation come, but the earth stays forever. That's what he found out. The sun will also rise, and the sun will always go down, and hasten to his place where he arose. And someone's going to ask us, between now and the answer to this question, when do you think, or what do you think life is going to be like in the next 5, 10, 15 years from you? What do you think it's going to be like around here on the earth? And the answer is what Solomon just said. The sun will come up and the sun will go down. And so here's the question is, what are you going to do with what you got? The sun coming up and the sun going down. That's what we do know. So he's going to work with what he's got. He's working with the sun coming up and the sun going down. He's determined that won't change. So I'm going to work within that stuff right there. Oh, okay. Verse 9. What has Solomon discovered? So when read, if you will. Chapter 1, verse 9.
The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun.
There is no new thing under the sun. Now, if you listen to Al Gore, he invented the internet. Mm-hmm. There's no new thing under the sun. Here's some quick examples. Einstein, if we don't realize it, he invented what?
Perfect.
Gravity. No, he didn't. He always knew that what goes up must come down. He always knew, everybody knew that, but how can I take advantage of that?
I think that was Isaac Newton.
Was that Newton? Einstein, the law of relativity. E equals MC squared.
Yeah.
What is that? E being what? Energy.
Energy.
M equals mass. Square is something times itself. Equals MC squared. E equals mass times the speed of sound squared. How fast does sound travel, and then multiply that times itself. This is something super number times super number, and that gives you the law of relativity. But here's what Solomon said, been around all the time. Ain't nothing new. But what happened was that the Einsteins, the Newtons, the Steve Jobs of the world found out that everything that's under the sun, when it rises and goes down, you can take it and make it work for you. Mm-hmm. Even flying in an airplane. See, there we just get on the plane. We get mad if it's late. Get up. Buckle up. Don't pay any attention to the safety stuff. And go to sleep when the plane just defies or supersedes gravity. We don't know who's operating it. They know what they're doing? Yeah, we take it for granted. Somebody has determined how to surpass gravity. So here's what Solomon is saying is that there is nothing new under the sun. I found out that it's going to be the next 20 years the same way it is the last 20 years. <That's what laughs> Same stuff will be here. Who's going to take advantage of it? Okay. So we'll keep going. Verse 12 of chapter 1. What does he say there?
I, the preacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem.
I, the preacher, was king. All right. Chapter 2. What did you say, Cameron?
Verse 13. I gave my heart to seek and search out by wisdom concerning all things that are under heaven
that I've done.
And this sore travail have God given to the sons of man to be exercised therewith.
God gave it to you. It's yours. Figure it out. What you want. Figure it out. Same thing somebody else I knew. Adam. Whatever you do with it, Adam, it's yours.
Whatever you call it.
Whatever you call it is yours. There it is. It's all yours. Whatever you want to do with it. So, and then he says, so Solomon says here that I got after. See what's happening. What can I make of this stuff? Then we said in verse chapter 2, verse 4. What did he say? This is him figuring it out. Wisdom. What did he say, verse 4?
I made me great works. I builded me houses. I planted me vineyards.
5.
I made me gardens and orchards, and I planted trees in them of all kinds of fruit.
6.
I made me pools of water to water therewith the wood that bringeth forth trees.
Okay. Verse 7.
I got me servants and maidens, and had servants born in my house. Also, I had great possessions of great and small cattle above all that were in Jerusalem before me.
I did it. I made it work for me. And that's my cattleman. I made it work for me.
Verse 9, he said, so I was great and increased more than all that were before me in Jerusalem. Also, my wisdom remained with me. And whatsoever mine eyes desired, I kept it not from them. I withheld not my heart from any joy, for my heart rejoiced in all my labor, and this was my portion of all my labor.
This is my portion. I'm just coming after myself. It's pretty good stuff going on here. made it, man. I even figured out how to make wood be a picture for my video. Get the water running through that wood. Hey, there you go. Hey, I would have to go out there and water it. Boy, I figured it all out. I got it going on so well that I got servants born in my house to work for me. And there was some popular man, I think right here out of Oklahoma, who says, I'd rather have the labor of 100 other men than 100% of my own. Mm. Mm-hmm. A smart man. I'd rather have the labor of 100 other men than 100% of my own labor to get something done on my behalf. Figured it, that's wisdom. Figured it out. Mm-hmm. Figured it out. I know someone like that, married one of my daughters. He said, he didn't know what kind of word to describe it. And he says, I'd rather get this work done and hire other people working for me than to be out there trying to do it all myself. That's, what do we call that, Sister Hill? You call that what? Leverage.
Call it what?
Leverage.
Oh, sure. Leverage.
Mm-hmm. Leverage. Mm-hmm. The man who, and I'm going to get on with the lesson, but I know the man, I met the man who owned and operated the first Quick Trip, 51st in Peoria. He was the only store open late at night in the early 60s, early 70s, all night long. And you go in there and get milk, and I mean, he's, hi, how you doing? He's the only store open back in that day. At nighttime, convenient, little bit of convenience store. Right now, you got Quick Trips where? You think he's in every one of them?
No, he
ain't in every one of them.
He can't make a
while. but he saw something. I got it. I'm putting me one of these Quick Trips everywhere I can find one. And they're in Texas and Kansas, Missouri, and all over the place. Still that same guy over all of them. Mm-hmm. What did he figure? He figured, I got it working for me. So this is what Solomon was doing, figuring out how to get it to work for him. Whew. Okay. Lord, bring me some riches. You think you'll answer that prayer? Lord, bring me some of the best stuff. Everything is in life. Lord, bring it to me. You think you'll answer that prayer, Sister Hill?
Well, that depends. See, if we're talking about Solomon, he asked for wisdom first.
Okay.
And because he asked for the right thing, then God grants.
Okay, give me the know-how, the ability. Now, guess what wisdom is? Wisdom is life skills, practical discernment, and experience. Life skills, practical discernment, and experience. Okay, now, so that's how he put it all together. My experiences in life, developing skills, and being able to discern what's going on. What's the life going to consist?
Simple definition, too. That's good. Wisdom is just the right application of knowledge.
Okay, there you go.
Right application.
There you go. There you go.
Appropriate.
Who's smart enough to make light? Well, it took Edison over 1,000 times the wrong way
before he discovered that. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Applying it the wrong way 1,000 times, and then he finally hit it. It was the right way. Guess what we got? Light. So you could do it that way too now. Just keep doing stuff wrong. The wrong way. How to have a good marriage? Well, keep marrying a pole dancer. How can I find a good way? I go to the clubs, the gentlemen's club. I just keep doing that until what? You find that that ain't working. What's the best route to find a good wife? Well, I wouldn't try church. Yeah. Wouldn't you, Brother James? Mm-hmm. Oh, check out one of them church girls. Yes. Wisdom applied, Sister Hill. What do you think? Wisdom.
Right.
How to find a good husband? I think you might want to go Check out the choir of the church. Ain't too many men singing in choir, but I guarantee you if there's one singing in there and he's single, he'll probably be a good guy. Let me move on.
They don't pay me to do that.
All right, so wisdom applied. So this is okay. Now, we're going to show you that this stuff, a discernment of how to do it, that's the best way to approach it, and all like that. Look at Ecclesiastes 7 and 11, and then we can get into our lesson. 7 and 11. And also verse 12. What does it say?
Wisdom is good with an inheritance, and by it there is profit to them that see the sun. Mm. For wisdom is defense, and money is a defense.
Woo.
But the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom giveth light to them that have it.
Fuck up the music last day. Money's good, but without wisdom, you just ain't got it going on. Money's a defense. You can buy an army with it. Glory to God. You can buy bodyguards with it. Do all you want to do with money. Except for the fact that it gives life to them that what?
Have it.
Now, wisdom gives life. Money can't give you life. You got all the money you got going, all the cha-ching you want. It will not give you a new liver. You can't buy one. Mickey Mantle tried to buy. You can't buy a lung. Just can't do it. Not with all that other stuff. But if you got wisdom, it'll show you how to what? Stay well and get well. And give you some life. So he was after, like Sister Hill says, he was after what? Wisdom. Okay, now we're going to see wisdom in some real stories in the Bible over the New Testament. Wisdom applied. Wisdom making it better. Wisdom making it happen. If you can get people to listen to you. But let's go into our lesson today, Ecclesiastes 9:13. And before we get there, let's read Ecclesiastes 9 and 11. What does that have to say? Okay, someone read verse Ecclesiastes 9, 11 through 13, if you have it, please.
I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth to them all.
Okay. In other words, opportunity came to everybody.
For man also knoweth not his time, as the fishes that are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the sons of men snared in an evil time, when it falleth suddenly upon them. Mm. This wisdom have I seen also under the sun, and it seemed great unto me.
It seemed great to me. So Solomon said, everybody's had their day. Everybody has a day. Opportunity comes your way. You got your chance. The New Testament says God, Peter says God is not a respecter of what?
Persons.
He don't care. Money don't care. Money don't care who's getting it. Ask financial peace class. You don't care. As long as you what? Know how to handle me. You don't care. You don't look for white folks, black folks, red folks, skinny folks, fat folks. It's whoever knows how to deal with you. That's how you get it. So, he says, I found under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor the bread to the wise. Which is the man of understanding. But so he says, you got to know how to deal with what you're dealing with. This is what Solomon is saying. Okay, now we're going to get to our lesson today. He's going to tell of a city that was conquered and a city that overcame. All right, verse 14. Someone read it, please.
There was a little city and few men within it. Mm. And there came a great king against it and besieged it and built great bulwarks against it.
Okay, an example would be like in Deuteronomy 20, chapter verse 19, what this king did once he conquered it. But basically what happens is that when a city, or when an army, a great nation, was on its way to conquer other nations, it would, and along the path, encounter a small nation or a small city. And the inhabitants of the city would feel that no one would spend any money on or any waste of military resources on conquering us because we are so small. So they won't even, you know, they're just going right on by us because they, you know, they feel like it's not worth the effort. So here was the, and so the people in the city felt somewhat confident and comfortable that they wouldn't get overran and killed and plundered. So here it is, false confidence would be a problem. There was a little city. That, so don't get your confidence messed around. And few men within it, in other words, small and insignificant. Oh, don't think like that, because the devil still wants to come and conquer you. And then he built up, as this is showing, he built up great walls around that city so that not only could the people in the city not get out, but the enemies that's on the outside can't get in. And so the army would also, these big walls that were built around the city, would put itself above on those walls and could see and shoot the enemy trying to come in and shoot those trying to get out because they made them slaves. So we said, well, wow, look what happened to us. We were insignificant and this great army, uh-oh, they made us slaves. Did anybody get to Deuteronomy 2019? I was just trying to see if that really shows us anything. It was a practice that they did quite a bit. All armies had this military maneuver.
When thou shalt besiege a city a long time, and making war against it and take it, war against it to take it, thou shalt not destroy the trees thereof, but by forcing an axe against them, for thou mayest eat of them, and thou shalt not cut them down. For the trees of the field is man's life to employ them in the siege.
Yeah, in other words, one reason why for taking that city is that it could be a resting place for my army. It could be a staging ground for my army. When we retreat, when the others come, I tell them, go over there and rest up and relax before you continue on fighting and take all the food and everything there. So when you take a city, military war, strategy is to don't destroy everything. Okay. Would that have worked in the Civil War? Get off the lesson here. If Sherman had not taken some city in the Carolinas, Sister Hill, I think it was. I forgot. But he took that city. It might have been Atlanta too. Took those cities.